I'm the Dean of the College of Humanities and Social Sciences, and I, along with Associate Dean Mark Geisler and Kirsten Anderson, who was greeting you when you came in, would like to welcome you to actually the final installment of the Dean's Lecture Series for this academic year. This presentation is brought to you by a great and long-standing partnership that we have with the City of Bellingham, who lets us use this wonderful venue, and also with BTV, who is recording this and will also show this, air this, multiple times in the coming months. So thank you to our Bellingham partners. At the end, there will be time for questions, and we'll have Mark Geisler stand up, and he'll kind of facilitate that discussion. So we have microphones put up on the side, so you can just say your question or ask your question loudly, and it'll pick up on the microphone. So part of the mission of the college states that students will learn to devise and apply innovative solutions, embrace divergent worldviews, and consider ethical implications of their actions. Tonight, Dr. Hud Hudson will help us do that as he discusses a critical evaluation of the fine-tuning argument for the existence of God. Dr. Hudson joined the philosophy department at Western Washington University in 1992 after he finished his PhD at the University of Rochester. And while at Western, he has won the Peter Elich Excellence in Teaching Award, as well as the Paul Olscamp Research Award. And I have to tell you, that is very rare for one faculty member to win the top honors in those two very important categories. Dr. Hudson specializes in contemporary analytic metaphysics and the philosophy of religion. He's published 4 books, including Kant's Compatibilism, A Materialistic Metaphysics of the Human Person, The Metaphysics of Hyperspace, and The Fall and Hypertime. As well, he's also published 50 articles in very prestigious journals and anthologies on a variety of topics, including ethics, metaphysics, Kant studies, mathematics, and the philosophy of religion. He's known worldwide for his research, and Dr. Hudson has given presentations in 20 states and 15 countries. I've had the privilege of working with Dr. Hudson for many years at Western Washington University, but it was only recently that I learned that he is a voracious reader. He reads, for the past 9 years, he has read 1 book a week. And he writes a summary and commentary of that book and posts it on his website. So that's every week for 9 years. I think I've read 9 books in 9 years. So now it's nice to know I don't have to read anymore because his summaries take much less time. So Dr. Hudson truly is a brilliant scholar and an amazing teacher. So it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Hud Hudson.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Leanne. Thank you, Mark. Thank you to the college for inviting me out to speak tonight. Thanks to you for showing up, listening to some philosophy of religion. It's one of the areas that I work in. Much of my writing overlaps philosophy of religion and contemporary analytic metaphysics. And it's an area where I teach. Maybe once per quarter, I teach a course in the philosophy of religion. I've taught at Western for 24 years. We've been together a long time. I like my university. I'm very fond of it, and it's been good to me over the years, and I'm delighted to be given this opportunity to share some of my thoughts with you about these topics. So, tonight I'm going to talk about one argument for the existence of God. It's a popular argument. It's an extremely popular argument. It's unusual in some respects. It's a member of the design argument family. And it's unusual because it relies very heavily on results in contemporary science. And that's unusual because many of its brothers and sisters in the design family are often attacked by the results of contemporary science. It's unusual in being maybe the most popular argument, or one of the most popular arguments, not popular, potentially persuasive for theism in modern literature. At least that's the claim that its main proponent makes on its behalf, Robin Collins, R-O-B-I-N-C-O-L-L-I-N-S. If you get any interest in this topic as a result of listening to me tonight, you should take a look at Robin Collins' website. He's made his papers available to a general audience. There are technical versions, there are non-technical versions. It's exactly where you should begin to look if you want to have responses to the kinds of criticisms that I'm going to offer you tonight. And also, for those of you who are here, you might want to take a look at the display table when you leave, and you can take down the information on Neil Manson's wonderful little anthology called God and Design. Amazon could have it at your doorstep in a week. If you read through those articles, you would be up to date on relatively recent work on the fine-tuning argument. So the first thing I want to look at on your handout is just a classification claim. A teleological or design argument for God argues from observations of some general patterns of order or complexity in the universe to the existence of a God responsible for those features. And the fine-tuning argument is a sophisticated version of a teleological argument. And I say sophisticated, but I don't say successful. I don't endorse this argument, which is unfortunate because I like the conclusion it's aiming at. I am a theist. I think that God exists. But one of the things that philosophers do is evaluate lines of reasoning for particular conclusions. And it turns out that you can't determine that an argument is a good argument merely by finding yourself in sympathy with its conclusion. So what I want to do today is give you an example of how somebody might try to undercut an argument for a conclusion that I believe in. Examples of the fine-tuning. There's no way to talk through a presentation of this argument without using some of the jargon. And sometimes the jargon can look a little intimidating or daunting, but I don't really think that it is. I think it's fairly easy to get your mind around the ideas. And so I want to stop every once in a while during the presentation to say something about how I'm going to use the terminology that appears in the statements that make up this argument. And the first pair of statements are cosmic conditions and life-permitting cosmic conditions. Sounds a bit grand, but it is grand. I mean, the cosmic conditions give you very interesting information. They tell you about the fundamental parameters of the universe. If I'm given a set of cosmic conditions, one of the things I might learn are the fundamental objects that exist. And I might learn further the general types that those fundamental objects fall into. Maybe they're fields. Maybe they're particles. Maybe I get a list of fundamental particle types. I also might get information about just how many instances there are of each type. I'll get information about fundamental forces. I mean, in our world, the candidates for fundamental forces are things like electromagnetism, the nuclear strong force, the nuclear weak force, and gravity. But there could be fewer or more foreign forces. And it's not just that there could be fewer or more. Even if you kept the very same fundamental forces, they could vary in their relative force strengths. So in addition to learning what the fundamental things are and what forces are operating on them, you get information about the relative strengths between the fundamental forces for a pair of objects at some precise defined distance. All of those little features can be tweaked. Change one of the values, you have a different set of cosmic conditions. And when I say that the cosmic conditions are life-permitting, every time I look up here, it's because I'm looking at the handout you have in front of me. to say that the cosmic conditions are life-permitting is to say that they satisfy another condition. If the cosmic conditions in question were in force, if they were the ones that were operative in the universe, then it would be physically possible for life to exist. But life is really shorthand for a much longer description there. I don't just mean life. I mean sentient, embodied, intelligent, free beings like you and like me. So when I'm talking about the conditions for life, replace it with that longer description, but it would be cumbersome to say it every time. And by sentient, I just mean you have some conscious experiences. By embodied, well, I guess I mean that I think you are a physical object, but even if you don't agree with me about that, if you were dualist, if you thought that you were an immaterial mind that had a two-way causal connection to a physical body, we could still run the main theme of the argument. And by intelligent, I mean to comment on your cognitive capacities, and you have some. You can sense things in your environment. You can introspect facts about yourself. You can anticipate future states of affairs. You can act and plan on those anticipations. You can remember recent experiences and not so recent experiences. You can imagine states of affairs that are quite fanciful, that won't ever answer to anything in your experience by taking the raw materials of experience and working them up, recombining them, augmenting, diminishing. You can understand something about yourself, something about the world, something about the relation between yourself and the world. You can reason. You've got the capacity to draw inferences. You can systematize. You might even have a faculty of a priori intuition. But the point is, you've got lots of cognitive features. They're the ones that I associate with personhood. Embodied, sentient personhood, and that fourth condition, that you're free. And by that I mean you meet what I think is a necessary condition for being morally responsible for some of the things that you do, for being the kind of thing that can act and have your actions evaluated from a moral point of view, to be the kind of an agent that can be evaluated with terms like virtue and vice, and responsible and praiseworthy and blameworthy. Those sorts of conditions. So again, cosmic conditions, they give you the fundamental physical parameters of a universe. Life-permitting cosmic conditions. Just those cosmic conditions that have the feature that if they were operative, if they were in force, it would be physically possible for there to be beings like you and me. Now, fine-tuning. You'll hear that the cosmic conditions have been fine-tuned for life. You can get the sense of the tuning image just by thinking about the radio in your car. And we've all done this. We've been driving down the highway, and you're fumbling around with the radio dial. And if you turn it a little bit too far to the left, the music's all scratchy. A little bit too far to the right, and it's bouncing in and out. If you get it just on the right click, then the car is filled with classic rock, just as it should be. Well, there are about 50 clicks on my radio dial in the car. But what if you had more than 50 different options? What if you had 10 to the 50th different options? And after a fair spin of that dial, I can promise you that by fooling around with the tuner for a whole afternoon, you're not going to find your music if it comes in on just one of those ticks. 10 to the 50th, a one with 50 zeros behind it. Those are the sorts of numbers that get thrown around when people talk about the conditions being fine-tuned for life. The fine-tuning examples show up in the laws of nature. They show up in the constants of physics. They show up in the initial conditions of the universe, very low states of entropy, for example. But it turns out that the fine-tuning literature can get very complicated very quickly. It's not tremendously accessible. If you have an appetite for that, again, go take a look at Robin Collins' website, and he'll give you as much as you want to put on your plate of the details of the fine-tuning. He's actually not just a philosopher, he also does original work in physics. He's a crossover figure. He's able to talk to both sides, and he's done some very nice work on the fine-tuning of the constants of physics. But since the criticism that I'm going to offer at the end of the talk doesn't really turn on the fine-tuning claim or the fine-tuning literature, I'll be happy just to leave you with a taste of the kinds of claims that are made about fine-tuning. And here's a taste. Take the nuclear weak force. If it were just a little bit stronger, appreciably stronger, then all hydrogen would have burned to helium in the first few seconds, and there wouldn't be any water or any long-lived stable stars. Or, if you think about the very initial moments after the Big Bang, there has to be a fine-tuning of the initial rate of expansion. John Leslie, who's written a book on this topic called Universes, gives these examples. Has to be fine-tuned to maybe one part in 10 to the 55th. Otherwise, there's an immediate recollapse, or the expansion is so unbelievably rapid that you don't have time for galaxies to form. Or if you look at the fundamental force strengths, it turns out that between two protons in a nucleus, you might have gravity and the strong nuclear force both at work, but the strong nuclear force is 10 to the 40th time stronger than gravity. Vary those relations a little bit and catastrophe awaits. I mean, one way or another, you end up with a world without life-permitting conditions. And the list goes on and on. But what I'd like to just say is what I put in italics here. There's a surprising and rather unusually widespread consensus on the evidence for fine-tuning among theists and atheists alike. When I say a consensus, I mean a consensus on what I'm going to call the fine-tuning thesis, which appears next on your handout. The range of life-permitting cosmic conditions is exceedingly small when compared to the total range of cosmic conditions for which we can reasonably make such determinations. So that's a comparison between two different ranges, but in fact, there are three different ranges involved. And I think it's nice if you have a kind of image to orient you. So suppose that we just have the room that we're in right now, and every little precise location in the room represents just one set of cosmic conditions, just one complete description of the fundamental parameters that a world might take. And now, suppose we just take one at random and look at it and say, well, what do we think? If the conditions were like that, if those were the cosmic conditions in force, would the universe be life-permitting or not? And to be fair, sometimes the cosmic conditions are so foreign to anything that we know about, so radically unlike anything in the actual world, the only responsible response would be, we have no idea. We're not in a position to make a determination about whether there would be possible life of our kind if the world were thus configured. So let's separate all the areas in this room into the areas where we're able to make some reasonable determination and the areas where it would just be beyond us. We wouldn't have anything reasonable to say about whether or not the conditions would be life permitting. So a subregion of the total region that there is, say just the region where you are in these seats, call that the illuminated range. Now, what the fine-tuning thesis says is that the range of life-permitting cosmic conditions, which appears within that illuminated range, some little range over where you're seated, is exceedingly small when compared to the total range of cosmic conditions for which we can reasonably make such determinations. So life-permitting, very small when compared to the illuminated range, which is just some of the total cosmic conditions that there are. That's the fine-tuning claim. Well, it's one thing to hear it. It's another thing to ask, how small is small? That's what you want to know, right? How little is the range? What's the relation between the volume of the life-permitting ones and the non-life-permitting ones where we can make some determination or other? And then the fine-tuning cases that I was just describing for you give an answer. It's the same as one part in, say, 10 to the 60th, one part in 10 to the 70th. And so you get one of those huge numbers, and you know how to count to 60. You know how many zeros to put behind your one. But that doesn't give you a feel for how big those numbers are. I want to give you a feel for how big those numbers are. Make it connected to some concrete experience that you can roughly imagine yourself having. So just take a single poker deck, 52 cards. There's lots of different ways to shuffle them up. There's 52 ways you could put down the first card. 51 ways the second, 50, 49. And if you want to know how many different possible arrangements there are, it's just 52 times 51 times 50, dot, 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 times 3 times 2 times 1. And the number is one of these huge numbers. It's about 10 to the 67th. Just the sort of number you see in the fine-tuning claim. Here's the concrete example. Go buy one of those countdown timers. Make sure it's really durable. And set it so that there are as many seconds that will tick away before you hear the buzzer as there are different ways to arrange those cards, as there are in one of these fine-tuning numbers, 10 to the 67th. Here's what you could do before your time ran out. Take a walk to the equator. Take one step every billion years. Walk around the Earth at that pace. When you get around once, take one drop out of the Pacific Ocean. Start again. One step every billion years, all the way around, one drop out of the Pacific Ocean. Do it a few times. In fact, empty the Pacific Ocean in this way. To celebrate your achievement, put one piece of paper on the ground. Well, you got some time. Fill back up the ocean and start your walk again. One step every billion years, one circuit, one drop in the ocean to nothing, one piece of paper on the ground. Stack the paper the distance from the Earth to the Sun. Take down your stack. Do it again. Same distance. Take down your stack. Do it a third time. Do it a fourth time. Do it 1,000 times. You still got lots of time left. Here's what you can do in your remaining time. Get yourself a poker deck. It's got to be a durable poker deck. It's going to last a while. Deal yourself one 5-card poker hand every billion years. If you get a royal flush, buy a lottery ticket. If you win the lottery, throw one grain of sand in the Grand Canyon. Repeat. One hand every billion years. If a royal flush, lottery ticket. If a winning lottery ticket, one grain of sand goes in. Fill the Grand Canyon in this way. Now, when it's full, celebrate by taking 1 ounce of rock away from Everest. Level Everest in this fashion. Do it again. Do it again. The 256th time you do it, your time runs out. Now, what are the chances? They're the same as correctly identifying a second with just one guess. A single second that was chosen at random from your first step around the equator to the 256th leveling of Everest. It's not much of a chance. There's a sense of how big those numbers are. And that comes from a wonderful little blog on the internet. You can find it if you just type in 52 factorial. You should look at it. There's some other interesting things there. 52 factorial. Mm-hmm. Or you can find it by typing in the phrase, it all starts with a deck of cards. All right. So we have a classification of the argument I want to focus on. We have some sense of what's involved in the fine-tuning thesis, some sense of how big those numbers are. And now we reach a general principle of reasoning. And I'd like to move the thing down a little bit. Yes. A general principle of reasoning. This isn't particular to this argument. It's a general principle you can find in lots of different contexts. And here's what it says. Given two competing hypotheses, H1 and H2, those will be our names for our hypotheses, an observation, we'll call it O, counts as evidence in favor of the hypothesis under which the observation has the highest probability. And so it's time for terminology again. By competing hypotheses, I just mean two hypotheses that can both be true. I mean, they can both be false, that's all right. Or maybe the one is true and the other is false, or the other is true and the one is false. They just both can't be true. And by probability under a hypothesis, I mean something very specific. Sometimes it goes by the name conditional epistemic probability. And this is one of the areas that can get very complicated very quickly. But again, what I want to get across in the amount of time I have is just a flavor of the kind of reasoning that I want to inspect. And so I'm going to do something in an abbreviated way, an informal way. But if you're interested in this, again, take a look at Robin Collins's website. He'll give you all the detail and technical sophistication you could hope for. But here's the informal way of doing it. If I ask about the probability of something I know, some observation, given some hypothesis that I'm curious about, I'm going to answer a question. And the answer to that question is going to be a number between 0 and 1. If I give the answer 0, it's not probable at all. In fact, no chance. If I give the answer 1, it's a certainty. And then any real in between is fair game. 0.5, 50% chance. 0.2, 20% chance. Those are the kinds of answers that are admissible answers. And then here's how I determine an answer. I'm going to play a game. I'm going to pretend that I don't know the thing I do know and that I do know the thing I don't know. So, what do I know? Well, I know the observation. I know that fact about the world, the thing I'm calling O. What is it I don't know? Well, whether this hypothesis is true. It's the thing I'm curious about. So to play the game, I have to reverse those. I pretend that I do know the hypothesis. Suppose that that's one of the things I knew. And I take also the background information that is held fixed between both sides of the debate. In this case, the most salient bit of it is the fine-tuning thesis, the comparison between those two ranges. And then, thus equipped, pretending I know the hypothesis and the background fine-tuning claim, I ask, how likely do I think the observation is to be true? And then I get my verdict, somewhere between 0 and 1. And let me give you an example of this principle at work. I think that's the best way to get a sense of it. The example says that O is my observation. So suppose you come visit me at work, and you notice that there's a deck of cards right by my computer. And I'm turning them over. I'm about to shuffle them. You say, wait, let me see. So I flash them for you. And as I am showing them to you, you notice something. You notice that they're in a very particular order. All the clubs come first, then the diamonds, then the hearts, then the spades. And within each suit, they're arranged ace, two, three, all the way up to king. Four of clubs, fourth card in the deck. And you say, that's interesting. And I say, yeah, it's my favorite organization. My cards are often in that organization. I put them down. And as we continue to talk, you form two hypotheses about what you've just seen. Here's the first one. They're in the arrangement that they're in just as a result of random shuffling. Hypothesis number two. They're in the arrangement that they're in because you've been trying to put them in that arrangement for the last hour, and you haven't been multitasking, and you haven't been distracted, and you've just been trying to put them into the arrangement that corresponds to your favorite pattern. I don't care how you work yourself down to those two hypotheses. I just want to consider, what if those are the two you're considering? Well, they can't both be true, so they meet our conditions of competing hypotheses. It's not that it's purely random and I've been trying my best to put them in a certain order. And then you play the game I've invited you to play. You begin first by assuming that you know that they're in the position they're in as a result of random shuffling. And then you ask, how likely is it that they're in this particular position? And the answer is easy. Just one chance out of all the different positions they could be in. One chance out of about 10 to the 67th. That's low. Then you try the game again, and you say, okay, suppose that what I know is that you've been trying to put them in your favorite order for the last hour without interruption. What chance do you give it then? Well, you better give it a pretty high chance. I'm really good at menial tasks involving cards. If I try to put them in my favorite order, I bet I get it wrong once in 1,000 tries. I'm giving myself a 0.999 at least. And that's a big gap. And so now I have the ingredients to appeal to my general principle of reasoning. Given two competing hypotheses, H1 and H2, the observation that we have counts in favor of H2, because that's the one under which it has the highest probability. And there's a parenthetical rider that I could have included in the general principle, but I didn't. The greater the discrepancy between your two verdicts, the more evidence it gives you for the hypothesis under which it has the greater probability. Now notice there's some things that the argument doesn't say. It doesn't tell you that the hypothesis is true. It's not that strong. It doesn't tell you that the hypothesis is more likely to be true than false. It's not that strong either. All it does is say, here's one very good piece of evidence for this hypothesis over that one. But that might turn out to be important. It's a little bit like learning that the defendant's fingerprints are all over the murder weapon. Maybe that's not enough to convict if it were the only bit of evidence you have, but against a certain background of evidence, that might be enough to nudge you into the reasonable belief in the verdict guilty instead of the reasonable belief in the verdict innocent or suspension of judgment. And I do think that people who are offering the fine-tuning argument often have that kind of a goal in mind. This isn't a conclusive argument for the existence of God, but it's a nudge argument. It's the kind of thing that, if it worked, might move you from a suspension of judgment to a reasonable or rational or justified belief in theism. So even though the conclusion is restricted, it's valuable. What do I need next? Well, I need to return to the main argument I really care about, the argument for theism. And so I have to get two premises, each which makes a claim about probability. I have the low probability premise and the high probability premise. Those are going to give me the two hypotheses that I care about. In this case, that God exists, and the other, that God doesn't exist. And quite obviously, those are competing hypotheses. Contradictory, they can't both be true. And so I state in premise two that the existence of life-permitting cosmic conditions is extremely improbable under the hypothesis that God does not exist. And I state in premise three, the existence of life-permitting cosmic conditions is very probable under the hypothesis that God does exist. The observation then, which is held constant, that the cosmic conditions that are actually in force are among the life-permitting ones. Now I've got all the ingredients I need. I don't have a defense of two or three, but I haven't tried to provide one yet. I don't have an attack on two or three, but I haven't tried to provide one yet. All I have is a statement of two and three. But I have enough on the board to make an observation. If one and two and three are all true together, I should be able to infer four. And four is the conclusion that the existence of life-permitting cosmic conditions counts as evidence in favor of theism, that God exists. over atheism. God does not exist. And again, since that parenthetical clause could have been up there, the bigger the discrepancy, the stronger the evidence, the proponents of this argument are often happy to say counts as very strong evidence of theism over atheism. All right, that's a stopping point, just a quick taking stock. We have the family of arguments that this belongs to. We have some sense of what's involved in the claim that the cosmic conditions are fine-tuned for life. We have that expanded notion of what I meant by the term life, embodied, sentient, intelligent, free beings. We have a statement of a general principle of reasoning that has very strong credentials. You find it all over the place in contemporary science. And then you have two premises which give you the ingredients you need to press the principle into action and to deliver a verdict that appears in four. You may turn over your handouts. Okay, before I offer any criticisms, I would just like to start by trying to figure out what the proponent of this argument thinks is defensible about it. So why would somebody think two is a truth? Why would somebody think that three is a truth? And so let me just start with a defense of the low probability premise. And there are as many different defenses as there are proponents of this argument. So I'm just going to try to report a sketch of a defense, permitting refinements down the road, and also a sketch of a standard defense, because there are very different approaches to defending this. But for what it's worth, I think this is pretty representative. The person who's asked to defend the low probability premise starts like this. Okay, I have to agree to play the game that you informally presented to me, so I'm going to presuppose that I don't know what I do know. And I'm going to hold the observation at bay. I'm going to pretend that that's what's up in the air. And then I'm going to pretend that I do know what I don't know. I'm going to assume the hypothesis that God doesn't exist. And then I'm going to combine that with the standing background information that the fine-tuning claim is true. So those are my tools I get to work with. God doesn't exist, and the fine-tuning claim is true. Well, my reasoning will go like this. If God doesn't exist, then the cosmic conditions are left to chance. And if the cosmic conditions are left to chance, then the fine-tuning claim told me what the chances were. They're about as good as, with one guess, selecting a second, chosen at random, from that entire period of time I described from your first step on the equator to the 256th leveling of Everest. Not a very high chance. What about a defense of the high probability premise? Well, this time I'm just going to ask you to read with me this one paragraph. And as before, this is a sketch. It's not completely refined. And it's a sketch of a standard line of defense, not the only line of defense. But it's pretty representative. If God exists, the cosmic conditions have been fixed by a being who is omnipotent, omniscient, and perfectly good. Features that ensure the ability, the knowledge, and the motivation to select cosmic conditions that will permit the tremendous goods arising from embodied, free, intelligent, sentient life like ours. Given such motivation, knowledge, and power, it's quite likely that our universe would have life-permitting cosmic conditions. All right, another natural stopping point. Not only do we have the argument and a general sense of its key terms, we also have a defense of its individual premises. So there are a number of strategies for response. And I find it interesting that the standard strategy for response, at least the one that I've read the most on, the one that I've participated in, is an attack on the low probability premise. It's an attempt to say that we make a mistake of one kind or another when we think that it's unlikely that the cosmic conditions would be life-permitting when we're allowed the background thesis of atheism and the fine-tuning claim. But after having said that, I'm just moving it to one side. It's not what I'm going to spend the rest of my time on today. I'm going to give you instead a reason to suspect the high probability premise, a reason to think that maybe we make an error when we think it is likely that the cosmic conditions would be life-permitting, given the background thesis that God exists. and the fine-tuning claim, although the fine-tuning claim doesn't do a lot of work on this particular argument. It's that God exists. And so if I want to raise problems for that, I just ask myself once again, a reminder. What is our reason for thinking that the probability that the universe contains life-permitting cosmic conditions is very high under the hypothesis that God exists? Presumably, because there's something so very valuable about such a cosmos. It's great. And the fact that it's so valuable, together with the fact that none of its competitors, and by that I mean the universes that preclude intelligent life, none of its competitors are as valuable, strongly suggests that such a cosmos would be selected by God. But I want you to tease apart some very different claims that are made in that response. One kind of claim is that we recognize a sort of value that our world, a life-permitting world, manifests. But another claim, and a strong claim, is that our world is good, all things considered. A very good world, all things considered. Not just that it has this element of goodness in it to be weighed up with whatever else happens to be there. And there's yet another claim embodied in that response, that the competitor worlds, the worlds that have cosmic conditions that are not life-permitting, are nowhere near as valuable, all things considered, as this one. And I wonder if we're really in a position to justifiably believe those sorts of comprehensive claims about value. So I want to give you some reasons to suspect that maybe we're not, that we're not in a position to endorse that particular defense. And to do it, I'll do my best to stop right at 15 minutes till. To do it, I just want to tell you a brief story about a different argument. There's something, some things, there's a whole collection of them, called arguments from evil. These are arguments that begin with some observation of evil in the world, its existence, its distribution, just how magnificent it is, that it affects the innocent, that it's inscrutable, that it's horrific. Lots of facts about evil to start from. And then it tries to show that this provides good evidence to believe that there's not a being described with the divine attributes. Considerations about evil, evidence against God. And one of the most popular versions of that argument from evil just begins with the observation that a being that has the divine features would prevent or eradicate certain kinds of evil unless there were a compensating good or a morally justifying reason that would explain permitting those evils. And then the debate shifts. It shifts to whether or not there is a compensating good or a morally justifying reason to permit these evils. And the atheist who's advancing the argument looks for a reason to believe that there are no such compensating goods. And the theist looks for a reason to resist that reason, looks for a reason to say you haven't shown that the premise is true. Now, what's interesting to me is that there is a set of claims that we can make about ourselves that turn out to give the theist in that other debate, the problem of evil debate, the tools to resist the atheist in the atheist's attempt to show that there is no compensating good or morally justifying reason. The reason I bring it up is that the very same tools which give the theist a kind of defensive maneuver against the atheist in the problem of evil debate that I'm thinking of now work against the theist. I think we can invoke them to give reasons to believe that we're not in a position to accept that line of defense for the high probability premise. So I want to tell you a little bit about the theses that work as a defense from evil, but perhaps as an objection to the fine-tuning argument as well. And they're on the list here. I'm going to call them epistemic humility theses, but they go under the name elsewhere, skeptical theism, but I've become convinced that that's a bad name. So I'm going to use the other name, epistemic humility theses. And I'm going to say a little more than you see on your handout, because I don't want you to confuse what I'm going to endorse with something that looks a little bit like what I'm going to endorse. So here's the first point. There's a lot of things we know about value. In particular, we know that embodied, free, intelligent, sentient beings have terrific value, magnificent value. You have all the value that comes into existence when you satisfy your moral obligations. You have all the value that comes into existence when you nurture a good character. You have all the value that can be had in free interpersonal relationships. Love, freely given and received. Tremendously good values. But what we don't also know, what is, as far as I can tell, we're completely in the dark about, is whether the possible goods and possible evils that we're aware of, that we do know of, are representative of the total possible goods and possible evils that there are. Second, we are familiar with some necessary connections between obtaining goods and paying the price of certain evils to get them. Necessary connections between goods and evils. It's no part of the criticism that we can't detect some of those modal connections. But what we don't also know, and what, as far as I can tell, we're completely in the dark about, is whether the necessary connections that we're aware of between possible goods and permitted evils are representative of the total range of necessary connections of this kind that exist. And then third and last, somebody might bring a state of affairs to our attention, maybe some actual state of affairs, and ask us for our judgments about it with respect to value. And my guess is we'll be pretty good at identifying some goods that are there, pretty good at identifying some things that have disvalue that are there. It's no part of the criticism that we're incapable of applying our theory of value successfully to individual cases. But what we don't also know, and what, as far as I can tell, we're more or less completely in the dark about, is whether the goodness and badness that I perceive in a state of affairs is representative of the total goodness, total badness that that state of affairs manifests. Now, epistemic humility theses. I'm not making claims that we can't know things about a theory of value or apply it or understand necessary connections between states of affairs. It's the representative claim. And why does it matter? Because if those observations about ourselves are accurate, then I think we have to relinquish that particular defense of the high probability claim. Here's why. We are able still to say that if God exists, then we have a being perfect with respect to power, perfect with respect to knowledge, perfect with respect to goodness. We're able to tease out of those three features that that being has, the motivation and the knowledge and the power, to select cosmic conditions that will generate some very good states of affairs. That's all still just fine. We are also able to identify our current state of affairs as one that has some magnificent goods. We don't have to take any of that back either. But what we're not yet in a position to do is say that our world is tremendously good, all things considered, because we're not in a position to rule out the existence of worlds which are far better than ours, incompatible with us, or necessary connections that take all these goods only if evil gets dragged along in its wake, necessary connections of which we're not aware. Similarly, we're not in a position to say of competitor worlds that have cosmic conditions that are not life-permitting, that they are not as valuable as this world on the whole. We can be sure that if God exists, the cosmic conditions will generate some very good states of affairs. But we can't merely map those onto ours without making some all-in judgments about value, everything considered, that the epistemic humility theses forbid us from making. So just to conclude, I think that as a result of those thoughts, I endorse something I'm calling the epistemic humility objection. The last thing on your handout, premise one. If the epistemic humility theses are true, we don't have good reason to accept the high probability premise in the fine-tuning argument. In fact, I think we're not in a position to assign any probability here whatsoever, apart from the interval 0 to 1, and that's not helpful. Two, the epistemic humility theses are true. There, I've said it. I'm vouching for them. I think they're true. I think they're independently, fantastically plausible, even if they didn't play any role whatsoever in a defensive move against the argument from evil. I think that the theist should recognize that those additional claims are true. Conclusion, so we don't have a good reason to accept the high probability premise in the fine-tuning argument. And to the extent that that was an essential premise in the fine-tuning argument, we don't have a reason to be moved or persuaded by the fine-tuning argument as I've sketched it here today. Thank you.
So you just need to elevate your voice a little bit, and you'll be picked up by the microphones, but speak loud enough for the rest of us as well. Questions?
Yes.
A question. You've been using the term theist. Why not deist?
I think that's an important question. Let me ask you briefly what you mean by deist, and then I'll try to give a fuller answer.
Basically, the idea that God is just putting down some basic physical rules, physics, gets the ball rolling, but is not really involved in any sort of moral intervention.
Right. If I used that term, I might still be able to run the argument with a deist hypothesis and the counter proposal that there's nothing in existence that's either deistic or theistic. And then I'd be able to run through the same list of considerations that I had before. The reason I selected the word theist instead of deist is that I'm trying to enter into the debate, which is largely carried out with hypotheses that select theism and atheism. But let me follow up on another thought that's really similar to the one you've just offered. It actually gives us a reason to doubt the low probability premise. So you remember when I was giving my sketch, I said, the person might think, I'll play your game. Suppose that I know that God does not exist, and suppose the fine-tuning claim is true. Well, first move. If God doesn't exist, then the cosmic conditions are left to chance. But suppose I have somebody who uses the word deist just slightly different than you do. He thinks that there is a being that's remarkably similar with respect to knowledge and power to the being that I was calling God and using theist to mark out, but doesn't share God's perfect goodness. I think that I would be disinclined to treat the thing that you had in mind when you said deism as a way of talking about God because it lacks the condition of essential perfect goodness. But that doesn't mean that I can't consider what it would be like if the cosmic conditions were selected by something omnipotent, omniscient, but not perfectly good. So now I go back to that argument for the low probability premise. If God does not exist, the conditions are left to chance. And my newly construed deist says, wait, I don't accept that. I think that God doesn't exist because I don't think there's anything that maps on to the classical theistic attributes, including perfection with respect to morality. But still, I think that that doesn't mean it's left to chance. There's this other individual who doesn't mess around in the world's concerns, doesn't take sides in a baseball game, doesn't turn out to be interested in the same way in our lives that we ordinarily take God to be. And then that person says, that's the being that sets the cosmic conditions. And then a different atheist says, wait, I also agree that God, as you have construed that term, doesn't name anything, that there is no God, but I don't think that there is an extremely powerful, knowledgeable being who doesn't care about us either. But I classify myself as an atheist, and I do think that the conditions are left to chance. And so that buildup is for this payoff. Imagine someone who's thinking about the defense of the low probability premise who says, wait a minute. That premise presupposes that the atheists all speak with one voice about how likely it would be that there are cosmic conditions that are life-permitting. But some atheists are very close to theists. It's just that they hold back on the moral perfection requirement. Other atheists aren't close to that sort of deist or a theist at all. They think that maybe the smartest, toughest things in the universe are human beings. And none of us set the cosmic conditions. And since atheism does not speak with just one voice about the conditional epistemic probability of the cosmic conditions being life-permitting, given the non-existence of God, we'd have a lot more work to do before we could establish the truth of the low probability premise. Depends on what kind of atheist you are. So maybe it's just a two-part answer to your question. I used the term theist because I wanted to enter the literature that I think you might be able to find that's quite popular in philosophical circles. If I had used the other term, I'd be willing to attack a different premise in the argument. Yes?
It occurs to me occurred to me that we also don't know that this universe might be the 10 to the 67th occurrence of a universe. There may be many of them, and so the reason that it is the way it is not improbable in that context at all.
Yeah, suppose I say, tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to deal a five-card poker here. And I'd like you to tell me what the chances are that you're going to see a royal flush. And you might say really quickly, about one in 650,000. I say, wait. That's the answer you might give if I deal only once. But what I didn't tell you is I'm going to deal trillions of times. That's going to be independent deals. What are the chances that you'll see somewhere or other, so to speak, a royal flush? Now they're in near certainty. And so when I'm trying to determine how likely it is, if the conditions are just left to chance, you might think, well, wait a minute, how many runs do I get at that chance? You were putting it, I think, successively. So I have, on a simple model, something like big bang, big crunch, big bang, big crunch. And at each conflagration, the cosmic conditions are reset so that you get a brand new chance at the cosmic conditions, independent from its predecessors, independent from its successors. And you think, give me enough of those, and it won't be surprising at all that one of them will have life-permitting conditions. So I like this because it attacks the other premise in that quick sketch for the low probability premise. Up here we had the observation, look, the atheists don't speak with one voice. There are many different ways to be atheists. Some of them think that if God doesn't exist, the cosmic conditions are left to chance. Some of them think that if God doesn't exist, the cosmic conditions are left to some other being that may have motivations of his or her own. In your case, even if we got past that premise and said, well, if the conditions are left to chance, then there's just one chance in, that presupposed we only had one run at it. And if you wanted concrete ways of thinking about what it would be like to have more than one run at it, you need to think about multiverse scenarios. A multiverse is a universe that is somehow partitioned. It's partitioned into separate sections, each of which operates with its own set of cosmic conditions. And the cosmic conditions in each partition of a multiverse are independent of the cosmic conditions in any other partition of a multiverse. And there are philosophical and physics-based reasons to be interested in the possibility of multiverses. There's a philosopher named David Lewis who wrote an absolutely brilliant work in metaphysics that set the agenda in contemporary metaphysics for about 20 years, called Plurality of Worlds. And his view was there are lots of disconnected spacetimes that vary in their cosmic conditions. There are different ways to get a multiverse, and you don't have to have disconnected spacetimes to do it. You could have more than three dimensions of space and partitions that give you three-dimension prisons, so to speak, each of which operates under its own set of cosmic conditions. You can have an extra dimension of time. And if you have a hypertime hypothesis, you might just have three spatial dimensions, but different hypertimes at which the spatial dimensions recur, and you can get your multiverse that way. Or you can get it through one of the physics-based approaches to a multiverse. I like it. The two questions we've just heard?
What was the name of the Lewis book?
David Lewis, Plurality of Worlds, 1986, Basil Blackwell.
Thank you.
So let me try out a response to the objection.
Yeah, good.
That sounds like a cheat, and invite you to say why it's a cheat. So the only reason why your claim about value is dubious is because you haven't built enough into your hypothesis. Your hypothesis is just about an omniscient, omnibenevolent, omnipotent God. Build in that God's also a creator who intends to create life. And now the probability is extremely high. One.
That seems right. When I build that in, do I sneak that in the divine attribute that I was calling perfection with respect to moral properties? And let me tell you how I'm seeing that particular property. When I think about something being morally perfect, I think of four things. I think it never does the wrong thing from a moral point of view. I think it's never blameworthy from a moral point of view. It always does the right things for the right reasons. I think that it has the very best virtues, or if there are ties, it has one of the unsurpassable sets of virtues. And then the other two claims are about motivation. I think it is inclined but not necessitated to create and sustain states of affairs with value. And I think that it is inclined but not necessitated to eradicate
and to prevent states of affairs with disgod. I don't think we get will create life under any of those four headings. So it won't be a way of taking the conception of God and the commitment that I had to that conception and saying I've overlooked one of the categories. It doesn't, that God will create life doesn't fall under omnipotence, omniscience, or perfect goodness thus described. If I have some reason to attribute a fourth category to God that goes beyond the conception that I was just using when I was reporting this argument, you're quite right. If I can get will create life out of it, I sure better guarantee that the necessary conditions for life are present, and that will give me a verdict of one. This is an instance of a very broad problem in thinking about these sorts of arguments that ask about the conditional epistemic probability of some observation, something you know, given some hypothesis that you're worried about. Because it's not usually just the hypothesis that you get to use. It's some standing background information. And I kind of skirted over that standing background information. I said, one of the things you get to know is that the fine-tuning thesis is true. So you've got a theistic hypothesis and the fine-tuning thesis. Now, what's your rational expectation that the cosmic conditions will be life permitting? But somebody might say, wait, how much information sneaks in? Do I also get to add that I know things about myself or the way the world is? Because it won't take much, by way of addition, to guarantee that the conditions are life permitting. And then I'll get an immediate answer of one, and my argument will not have the force that it's supposed to have. Let me shout out to Robin Collins again. He has a very nice discussion in a paper on his website that he says is not the lay version. it's for the would-be expert. But as you look at this paper, he gives a principle that tells you which things you can put into the background information and which things you can't. That's not directly on the point you just offered. I'd try to get my first response, but it's related to it. It's the follow-up where you might have it.
Is there a reason that you included all three epistemic humility theses in the argument? Could one succeed, at least one, with the whole argument succeed, or do you need all three to succeed?
I put all three in because I like them so much, and I want more people to think about them, and I want people to see the difference. It might be the case that just one would do the trick and three is overkill. But they each make a slightly different sort of point. You get a little bit further into the door by putting one right after the other. But I think you're right, one of them could do the trick. If I were limited to just one, I'd talk about the necessary conditions thesis. For all I know, the presence of beings like us with all the goods that we bring to the universe prohibits the existence of something far, far better, or drags along by way of necessary condition chain some tremendous, horrific evil in its wake that we're not aware of.
So, Hud, I want to ask you about premise two again. I really like the first two questions, and so this is in the same sort of spirit. I'd like to appeal, though, to something in the ballpark of your epistemic humility theses, not those in particular, but the phenomenon in general that you know I care about. And then I just want to ask a couple questions, and it's related to premise two. So the fine-tuning thesis says that the range of life-permitting cosmic conditions is exceedingly small when compared to the total range of cosmic conditions. And we have this lovely little writer for which we can reasonably make such determinations. Of course, that needs to be in place. My question then is, begin with this, are those, is the total range of cosmic conditions for which we can reasonably make such determinations representative of the total range of cosmic conditions, full stop? Suppose we're in the dark about that, then mightn't the sort of epistemic humility, I would call it intellectual humility, that you display on the second page of the handout in relation to the problem of evil come to play here?
What will it make me take back? I like that consideration. I hadn't thought of it before. What would either a proponent of the argument or I have to take back that I have said or that person has said under this sort of thought?
Well, I don't know. I'm just wondering whether the person thinks that we're not in the dark about this matter, and if so, why?
Mm-hmm. Let me see if I get the point. Suppose that I said the illuminated range is just the region of the room where the chairs are, and then the non-illuminated range is all the rest of the area in this room. And I have a claim that there is a life-permitting pocket of cosmic conditions that's so tiny you couldn't begin to see it somewhere in the illuminated range. And now what I'd like to know is the ratio of volume between that little pocket and the illuminated range the same kind of ratio I would find if I opened it up, didn't restrict myself to the illuminated range, and found that there are life-permitting conditions here, there, and the other place, would I get the same 1 to 10 to the 60th verdict? Is that the idea? And I'm completely in the dark about that.
Maybe I'd get much higher ratios.
Right. It might turn out that the whole place is swarming with life-permitting cosmic conditions, and I'm not able to see it, and I should admit that I'm not able to see it as a result of an analog of the epistemic humility claims.
Maybe. I mean, I don't know. That's the question. Are we in a position to make that judgment?
I'm trying to run with the thought. What if we became convinced that we extend our epistemic humility one more step so that we have this verdict, and then we encounter this worry? What should we say if it turned out that we get one ratio when we consider the illuminated range, but just suppose that every other possible cosmic conditions is life-permitting? Now the total range of life-permitting cosmic conditions is quite high, quite big compared to the other one. And John Leslie, I mentioned that name earlier, wrote a book called Universes, maybe in the 70s, I can't remember. And he took on a question of this kind, and he said it will still be very surprising if you find that ratio in the illuminated range. So suppose, here's a quick image, maybe we can end on this image. Suppose that you're firing bullets at a vast canvas, and there's a gigantic dartboard, maybe it's a 1 mile radius, it can be huge, and there's only one fly inside the dartboard range. But all of the other galaxy-sized backdrop against which that little white bullseye is present, swarming with flies. You couldn't shoot a bullet somewhere else without hitting a fly. If a bullet is shot and it pierces the only fly that appears within the illuminated range, where there's absolutely nothing else around, that's the kind of thing that calls out for explanation. So I realize I'm shifting a little bit from the presentation of the fine-tuning argument that I offered to one of the other fine-tuning arguments in the literature with how surprising you would find it if something this unlikely were to happen. And you can create that surprise even if you endorse the epistemic humility thesis that would be the fourth on our list. Imagine the rest of the volume of the room that's not the life-permitting range is absolutely packed with life-permitting cosmic conditions, and yet still find the ratio within the illuminated range. It will be something like hitting the one fly in a dartboard that has only one fly with a mile radius. There's still something we can do even if we restrict ourselves to the illuminated range. I think that's the thought.
Thank you.
So please join me in thanking Dr. Hudson for a great Thank you.